sing our praises to God this morning.
Wherever you may be, and I'll meet you all in the dance, said he. us have our opening prayer. Father God, we thank you for this time together. We thank you that you allow us to come and praise you, to allow us to come and thank you for all the things that you've done for us and all the things that you're doing for us. We ask that you continue to guide this service. Allow it to be a blessing to you in Christ's name. Amen. You may be seated. Good morning. Yeah, everybody's asleep with Landon. Good morning.
Good morning.
Very good. Very good. All right. It is so good to see all of you this morning. And I believe everyone is out of the hospital or out of rehab. So we praise the Lord for that. And now everyone is at home recovering and recouping and getting much better. So we thank God for that. Autumn wind today at 2. Exercise class Monday and Thursday at 9. Bruce Circle Monday at 12. Lori Circle Monday night at 6 p.m. Online Bible study Tuesday night at 7. Wednesday morning Bible study at 10 a.m. All are invited. Prayer Shawl Meeting Group Wednesdays at 1 p.m. Family meal Wednesday at 5:15, followed by M&M youth and confirmation classes, and adults are in there as well. So we are enjoying that. Thank you, Ms. Bloomfield, for coming forward this week. Charge Conference Tuesday, October 11th at 6. I'm sorry, 7. It's at 7, right?
If we're here by 6.
If you're here by 6, you go sit an hour. So come at 7. We'll start signing you in. 7 o'clock.
It starts at 7, but I'm
7 o'clock, so come sign in. 7 o'clock, come sign in. 7 o'clock, come sign in. 7 o'clock, come sign in. On the 11th. 7 o'clock in the evening, not the morning. 7 p.m. Come sign in. We'll get started by 7:30. If you need a ride and can't drive after dark, please let Linda know this week so that we can plan to pick you up. All right? And we'll run both vans if needed. Okay? Charge conference. Same time, 7 p.m.
Prayer group tomorrow.
Prayer group. Needed right after church today. Him, one bread, one body. Oh, wait, we're not doing it. So, next Sunday after church, we are going to vote for where we would go as a church if we were to disaffiliate. So the three choices you need to study this week are global, congregational, and free. Those are the three Methodist possibilities that we will be looking at next Sunday. And if we should disaffiliate on the 11th, then whatever you decide next Sunday will be our choice. So we will put out a ballot at the end of church next week. So you will want to be here to decide your future. So pray about that this week, study about that this week, and come ready to decide next Sunday what kind of Methodist you want to be. All right. Anything else? Don't forget. I'm sure there is. Story of my life. All right, one bread, one body. Let us.
One bread, one body, one Lord of all.
here in New Boston, Texas. Also, Nan Mosley, she suffered a stroke last week. She's still in St. Michael's. Continue to pray for Natalie Goodman. Melanie's down there with her in College Station. But continue to pray for her continued health. And B.C. Pierce is going to go to the hospital tomorrow. He broke something when he was walking on Friday. And pray for him and also Kay Smallfoot. But anyway, if y'all want to, we'll open up the prayer route if y'all want to come forward and pray. Jeanette Crouch, oh my goodness, did you break your wrist?
Yes, sir.
You are tougher than the big brother, Ms. Crouch, being here today. We are proud of you.
I think somebody's following
me. Jeanette, it's good to have you this morning, broken wrist and all. Goodness.
Pray for service this week.
Amen. So everybody, y'all just come forward as you feel led. Dear Lord, as we come to you this morning as a community of believers, we'd ask that your hand be over our church. Lord, we may not be able to agree on a time, but we agree on one thing, that you are in control. And as we go through these coming weeks, deciding on discernment, deciding on where you're leading us as a church, we'd ask that you lead and guide us as you did the Israelites in the desert so long ago. Lord, give us counsel, give us wisdom, give us guidance. And Lord, for those that we've mentioned this morning on our prayer list, we'd ask that you touch their families, that you touch them individually, and place your healing hand upon them. Whether it's surgery, whether it's recovery, whether it's rehab, or whether it's condolences, Lord, we realize that you can bring the peace that no one else can provide. And Lord, as we continually stray away from you, we'd ask that you keep calling us back, and that we as a sinful people will return once again to you to bear the sword of truth, the Bible, Lord, that we return back to you, that we would ask for forgiveness, and that you would once again bless our homes, bless our nation, and bless our church in ways that we can't even imagine. And Lord, we'll ask all this in the name of your Son who taught us to pray, our Father.
Pray.
Can you pray?
Uh-huh.
Lord,
provider of us. Well, you'll get to work at the church pretty soon. Yeah, the 26th. Okay? All right, we're going to pray. You ready to pray? You telling me to shh? Okay. All right, we're going to pray. Lord, we thank you for all these people. We ask that you will watch over them and keep them and bless them. Bless the parents, bless the teachers. Watch over the teachers, give them patience, and allow them a great day. In Christ's name, amen. That's right. You get it, boy. Yeah, you get it, boy. You get it, preacher. She said that to her brother as he was playing something on a video. You hear her in the background going, "Get it, boy."
It was a gospel song,
yes. All right, if I can have the ushers come forward. Let us pray. Father God, we ask you to take our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings, that you would use them to further your kingdom on earth as it is in heaven, and that you would have us to be the stewards that you would want us to be, that we might deliver your word throughout this world and throughout the Boston. In Christ's name.
The
May be seated. So keep on pushing. How many soldiers do we have? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Soldiers. Soldiers. Not just God's army. So how many of you remember forced road marches? How many of you remember why they were forced? They were forced because you had to force yourself to go on them because you had to carry all your equipment. Do you remember that? Remember carrying all your equipment? I knew some guys that would go in and they would take their sleeping bag and they would put it inside their rucksack so that it wouldn't look like, it would look like it was full and it wasn't. And then they didn't have to force themselves so hard, you know, because they could just carry them just fine. But those rucksacks, when they were full, would weigh anywhere between 60 and 80 pounds. So when you see those guys walking down the road or whatever, and they've got those rucksacks on, they're carrying 60 to 80 pounds on their back. And
Ours was forced into the mountains of Germany. We would have to walk the mountains of Germany. And of course, if you were a medic, you had another 20 pounds of medical equipment on your side that you also had to carry up with your rucksack. So, you know, they were carrying more than everybody else. And they had to run back and forth to keep checking on everybody through the whole formation, just to make sure everybody was doing okay and encourage them to move along and keep going and all those good kind of things. So there was times that the medic's job was really hard. There was a lot of times when it wasn't, but there was a lot of times when it was. As I was thinking about that, I realized that the Roman Empire had a rule that when they were carrying their equipment, they could ask any citizen 12 years old and up, or any Jew 12 years old and up, to carry their equipment for a mile. And it was a law that if you were 12 years old and above, you had to carry that soldier's equipment for a mile. So, you know, if it was a busy street, then the soldier probably wouldn't have to carry his stuff very far at all, because he could just go 1 mile and make somebody else carry it, right? Just keep getting somebody else to carry his stuff. Well, it was in light of that law that Jesus wrote the rule that if someone asked you to go 1 mile, you should go 2. I think a lot of times as Christians, we get tired in the 1 mile and we don't want to go the second. Does that sound pretty familiar?
Yes.
1 mile is enough, right? Well, you know, I only have to do 1 mile. So why isn't that good enough, right? Especially in this world that we live in today, where kids don't want to do anything. Teachers don't want to do anything. Adults don't want to do anything. We live in a nation of kings. Everybody wants everything to be done for them. Right? Am I right?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm just making sure, huh? Let's look at some scripture in Galatians chapter 6. Brothers, if someone is caught in a sin, you who are spiritual should restore him gently. Did that say if someone's caught in a sin, go beat them over the head with what they ought to be doing right?
Not yet.
Not yet. Brothers, if someone is caught in a sin, you who are spiritual should restore him gently. But watch yourself, or you also may be tempted. Carry each other's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. Here's the problem. We're supposed to bring people who are in sin away from their sin. In order to do that, you have to judge that they are in sin. Is that correct? But then we say, well, we're not supposed to judge. So who is it for us to judge? But folks, you are supposed to judge one another within the body of the Christ. Did you know that? It's not your place to pass judgment on the world, but it is your place to judge one another and hold each other accountable. But see, we have for so long said, well, grace, 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 that we have forgotten that grace means, yes, we love you in spite of the fact that you've been caught in sin, but we're not going to leave you in sin. If we leave you in sin, then we are as guilty as you are. If we accept you in sin, then we are as guilty as you are. The problem is, there are so many preachers who are in sin
that don't want to be called on their own sin so they don't call anybody else on theirs. What? Did I hear him right? Did he just say preachers are sinning? Yes, they are. If a preacher is in the job for a paycheck, he is sinning. And the list goes on from there. That's the easy one. Right? So, I mean, start at the top, work your way down. Right? Look at the man in the mirror, as my production said, right? Look at him first. Right? Because until I judge myself, I can't judge someone else within the body of Christ. Until I'm right and living how I'm supposed to be, then it's hard for me to say, well, guess what? You're not living right, and now I need to call you on your sin too. Being gentle to bring somebody away from their sin goes to the verse that says, as you judge, so shall you be judged. So if I'm gently bringing you away from sin, then I want to be gently brought away from mine, right? I mean, I don't want somebody to just crucify me, right? So I have to love you. My daughter the other day, I got a little carried away when we went to pick her up at the hospital with this guy that was honking his horn. And I get in the car, and my daughter's like, you'd have been preaching against us for that. I said, I have never told you to let somebody run over you. Yeah, but you used the word Jack A. I said, it's in the Bible. It means donkey. And he was being one. He had to be there. But she was somewhat right, but she's not very gentle in her rightness. Yes, she is, my daughter. Reminds me every day. But watch yourself, or you may also be tempted. When he started acting like one, so did I. I was tempted. Fell into that temptation. You know? It's easy to do. It's easy to lose who we are. It's easy to lose what we're doing. It's easy to lose that we are Christians and that we're called to stand up for what is right. It is easy to lose our way, especially out in the world. If anyone thinks he is something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. Each one should test his own actions. Then he can take pride in himself without comparing himself to somebody else. For each one should carry his own load. Anyone who receives instruction, anyone who receives instruction in the world must share all good things with his instructor. Do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows. The one who sows to please his sinful nature, from that nature will reap destruction. The one who sows to please the Spirit, from the Spirit will reap eternal life. So are you trying to reap eternal life, or are you trying to reap what the flesh wants?
Are you looking to the flesh and what it wants? Or are you looking to the spirit and what it wants? Because in the spirit, you reap what? Eternal life. In the flesh, what do you reap? Death. Death. Let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers. So think about that. Especially to those who belong to the family of believers. You see, sometimes we think the family of believers are everybody that we go to church with. Is that the case?
No.
Are there non-believers in the company of believers?
Yes.
Are there believers in the company of non-believers?
Yes.
Well, sure there are. Sure there are. There are people in here who have not committed to Christ the way you have. There are people who don't understand it as you've understood it. There are people that have yet to be called by God. And yet, they've been members of the church. Some since birth. So if there are those that believe in the church that are believers, and if there are those in the church who have been a family in the family of the church but not in the family of believers, how do we treat everyone good? We love everyone the same. The problem is, if you're in the body of believers, you're going to be called out on your sin. Hopefully with gentleness and love and grace, in a way that would be pleasing to God, to bring you back to a place that you can go before God and say, "Yes, I have sinned. Forgive me, Father, and allow me your grace." Isn't that what we're supposed to offer? You see, that's Methodism. That's where the church got it right. There are denominations who shoot their wounded. Okay? You know, the one that had an affair and all of a sudden that whole family shunned. So much so that they get kicked out of the church. Because they don't feel like they can go back because they can't face anyone and there's nobody there to love them. There's nobody there to love on them in spite of what they did wrong. Happened. There are churches that will kick somebody out because they've been caught in sin. Is that restoring them gently? No. Some denominations say, well, they weren't really saved to begin with. Who are you? Who are you to say that about somebody? I can't judge what's in your heart. I don't know the commitment you've made to God. I know the temptation of the flesh is always there. I know it's a struggle for every one of us. Not so much as you get older, maybe. Then I meet some people in this town, so never mind, forget I said that. Forget I said that. It's amazing. It's amazing. We're supposed to love each other. We're supposed to say, I see you have a problem. Is there anything I can do to help? Or, I had that problem too, and this is how I got over it. 1st, commit yourself to Christ. Are you committed to the Christian walk? Think about that. Is your walk, the Christian walk, are you committed to it? Because Jesus said, if you go with somebody a mile, you go with them too. I tell you what, let's look at that scripture in Matthew chapter 5, if we'll look at it up there. 38-42. You have heard it that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I tell you, do not resist an evil person. If someone strikes you on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. Now that's not fair for some of us, because I can take a punch on the right side, and I can take one on the left. You best watch out for what's coming after that. Okay? Knowing that gives me an advantage, because I can turn the other cheek. I can take the two hits. Lord help you beyond the two hits. Right? But then you have to go to what Peter said. Lord, how many times must I forgive my brother? And he said, what, 70 times? 490 times. You forget as you're counting 490 times. I can't take 490 hits. An eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. But I tell you, do not resist an evil person. If someone strikes you on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. And if someone wants to sue you to take your tunic, let him have the cloak as well. If someone forces you to go 1 mile, go with him 2 miles. Give to the one who asks you, and do not turn away from the one who wants to borrow from you. That's tough. That's tough stuff. So, you mean I got to go a little further? As a Christian, we have to go a little further. Right? As a Christian, you're going to be called to do things that you do not like being voluntold to do. Right? Like walking a mile with a soldier's stuff. But the reality is, Jesus said, as a Christian, I don't want you to just go 1 mile. I want you to do more than what is required of you. I want you to be a witness for me. And that second mile is a witness to what Christ was compared to who we are. You see, we're supposed to know each other by our fruits. And going 1 mile in these days, I mean, that could be Christian fruit, because nobody wants to go a mile anymore. You know? But going with somebody the extra mile, going with them to the hospital beyond your need to go with them to the hospital, is the second mile. Doing what is not expected. It was a law for the soldier to be able to just share his load with anybody that was 12 years old or older for a mile. But don't you think it said something to him when they said, oh, but my Lord says I must go another mile with you. And they go that second mile. Don't you think that changed things? Don't you think that soldier went, what? Are you crazy? I know how much that stuff weighs. You're going to carry it another mile? What's wrong with you? I'm a Christian. know. Well, you know, it's my Lord who wants me to go that second mile, you know. And you do it joyfully, because in all things, do it as if you're doing it for God. Wow. So, all right, so I have to go 1 mile. Now I have to go 2. And now, well, now I've got to do it happily. I got to be happy. You know, that's you know, I was good to, I guess you can't be happy about it. You know, I get it. How many of you think it's happy for the preacher to have to go love somebody gently back to the fold after they've been caught in adultery? We had this, when I was growing up, we had this couple who switched partners. These two couples. Okay? They were best friends. And so, yeah, all the way. And so somewhere, I mean, we were friends. And so somewhere in the best friend relationship, they decided they'd be better off with each other's spouses. And so they already had kids on both sides of this. And my friends were some of the kids that I was in school with these kids. We were all in the same class. And, you know, that was back when sin wasn't so noticeable, I guess, or prevalent. People didn't get divorced, let alone you didn't get divorced and switch couples. And they all stayed in the church. Now, I don't know about you, but I was not going to be the pastor of that church. That is not the Thursday night counseling I signed up for. You know? I mean, what in the world? Have you lost your mind? You know? And hey, I guess it worked for them, but really? Really? You know, I do counseling from time to time, and I'm surprised at the things that come through my office, always. Because people will tell their pastor anything. But I would not have wanted to be sitting there with those two couples. I mean, how do you go tell your kids, hey, meet your new mom? Oh, by the way, this is your new brother and sister. You know, really? Now, if that can happen in the church that I was in, it can happen in any church. Because we were the Baptists of the Baptists. We had Jerry Caldwell. You know, I mean, we were it. You know? If that can happen there, it can happen anywhere. You know what the good Baptist folks say? Well, they just weren't saved to begin with. Who are you to say that? It's not our place to judge whether they were saved or not. It's our place to bring them back to the understanding that this is against God's law. That's what you're supposed to do. Don't get any ideas. I'm lost.
Second Corinthians.
Imagine that. Second Corinthians chapter 8. Thank you. And now, brothers, we want you to know about the grace that God has given the Macedonian churches. Out of the most severe trial, their overflowing joy and their extreme poverty, welled up in rich generosity. For I testify that they gave as much as they were able, and even beyond their ability. Entirely on their own, they urgently pleaded with us for the privilege of sharing in this service to the saints. And they did not do as we expected, but they gave themselves first to the Lord and then to us in keeping with God's will. So we urged Titus, since he had earlier made a beginning, to bring also to completion this act of grace on your part. But just as you excel in everything, in faith and speech and knowledge and complete earnestness, and in your love for us, see that you also excel in this grace of giving. So folks, this church is an amazing church. I've seen y'all give beyond what you were asked. I've seen you go that extra mile. It's a beautiful picture to see and watch you work. And for the last year, that's what I've been doing. I've watched you work, and I've tried to decide who is what, who is where, who does what, and who's the best at it, and all those kind of things. And so you see me watching you, and I have been. I've been studying you for a year. You know, I've never seen a church take care of the pastor's wife as well as you do. Never. Little gifts here and there, the words of encouragement, strengthening her, just phenomenal. Thank you. Because she is my number one, so thank you. That's an amazing thing. You don't always see that in churches. And I've watched you do that. I've watched you go out to eat on Friday nights and not just love one another, but love everybody that's in the restaurant. It's an amazing thing. It's an amazing feat that you do. I've watched you at the football games joke and cut up, and not only with each other, but with everybody from every different church. We have made impacts across this community in ways that they don't even know it's tap doing. It's amazing. From the newspaper to the city council to the chamber of commerce, we have somebody making a difference in every aspect of this community. It's amazing. Church feet. You're absolutely phenomenal. Your love for each other is boundless. It's amazing. So I get it when Paul is writing this to this church, I'm like, that's our church. I see that with us. You know? Amazing. But are we doing everything? Are we walking the Christian walk that we're supposed to walk? Not just as a church, but individually. But just as you excel in everything, in faith and speech and in knowledge and complete earnestness and in love for us, see that you also excel in this grace of giving. I am not commanding you, but I want to test the sincerity of your love by comparing it with the earnestness of others. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for our sakes he became poor, so that you, through his poverty, might become rich. And here is my advice about what is best for you in this matter. Last year, you were the first not only to give, but also to have the desire to do so. Now finish the work so that your eager willingness to do it may be matched by your completion of it, according to your means. For if the willingness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what he does not have. Our desire is not that others might be relieved while you are hard-pressed, but that there might be equality. At the present time, your plenty will supply what they need, so that in turn, their plenty will supply what you need. Then there will be equality. As it is written, for he who has gathered much did not have too much, and he who gathered little did not have too little. So what does that tell us? What is the next step? All right, so here it is. Don't you understand it? We have 51% poverty in our community. If we went over to the impoverished part of our community and said, help me put a gas, a tank of gas in my car, they could not help us. And why is that? They don't have it. And we haven't done what?
Given out of our excess.
We haven't helped them get there. You see, it's not just in giving it out, because you got to teach a man to fish, right? You don't just give the fish away, okay? You got to teach them, right? Folks, in order for us to reach, grow this church, and reach that side of our community that's not being reached, we're going to have to step out of our comfort zone and look at people that don't look like us. We're going to have to give to them in a way that helps them be able to give to us when we are in need. You say, well, I don't know how to do that. Well, that's it. God does. You teach them to be better than they are. You teach them how to budget. You teach them how to fish so that they don't have to just come ask for a free fish. Right? And we haven't done that. And we have all the excuses in the world. Well, they really don't want our help. They may not. They may not. And I'm sure that there is a portion of our society who doesn't want help, they just want the handout. I'm sure. But there is a portion that wants to be better than they are. Who wants the hand up and not the handout. And those are the ones that we have to weed through the others to find. Because folks, that's who you want in the church. The go-getters that are out there in the world who don't know how to go get it, but man, they would if they knew how. We have to start witnessing and being Christians like Christ. Loving people beyond their sin, bringing them away from their sin, because God doesn't leave us in sin. He never has. If you truly love somebody, you're not going to leave them to die in their sin. What do you reap when you seek the Spirit?
Eternal life.
Eternal life. What do you reap when you seek the flesh?
Death.
Death. We have to be the Christians that carry that to the people. Are you walking the Christian walk? You are here at church. It's beautiful to see. But are you continuing it beyond these walls? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Today I'm going to get someone to help me with communion. Yes, sir.
Miss Graham thought I was pointing at her.
Yeah, I thought
about you. Oh, dear.
like even me. It's all that Indian blood. Don't kill me. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and before one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us from joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. This proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your heart.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church and delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made for us a new covenant by the water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread and broke it. We offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of the faith. Christ has died.
Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here on these gifts of bread and wine that can be for us the body and the blood of Christ that we may be for the world, the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with his Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you. see you trying to do something like that.
Let us pray. Father God, how wonderful it is to get to come before you and to have communion with you and with each other is a wonderful, wonderful time of a Christian. We thank you so much for this opportunity in your Son. We ask that our light would so shine before the world that you would be glorified through us, that people would come to know you because of our world. We ask these things in your Son's precious name. Did y'all see my little Catholic girl this morning? Your daughter's in the wrong denomination.
You're probably right.
Yeah, she came right up and she's like, I'm a little bird, boy. That's two times in a row, baby. And last month and this month, so she's trying out all the denominations to make sure she gets within in the body. Let us stand and sing "We're Marching to Zion."
We serve.